Okay, Michael, are you ready?
I am afraid so.
All right. Which one do you want to fill out first?
Let's just do them in order. So one nearest neighbor, you explained how the training works. We just take the sorted list and leave it there.
Mm-hmm.
And we have to the classifier or the regressor itself has linear space. And now at query time, we need to find the nearest neighbor,
mm-hmm.
which we could do by taking the query point and running through the whole list and seeing which one is closest to. But because it's sorted, I think we ought to be able to use binary search and in log time find the closest point to the query.
That's exactly right. You should be able to do that in log base 2 time. What if it weren't sorted?
Yeah, then, like I said, I think you can just scan through the whole list, and that would be linear time, and that's not a big deal.
Right. Yeah, we could do it in linear time, but because I gave you a sorted list because I'm so helpful, you can do it in log time. Okay.
That was very, very thoughtful of you.
It was. I thought it through. So what about on the space side?
All right. So the amount of space that you need to process this query is linear. We don't need to take any special set-aside space beyond a couple simple variables and the data that we're given, which we've already accounted for.
Right. So then why would it be linear if we've already accounted for it?
Did I say linear? I meant constant.
Yes. Yes, that's right. Constant. That's what you meant. That's what you said. That's what happened. Okay.
It's a good thing that this wasn't being recorded so we can verify one way or the other.
It is a good. Maybe we'll look it up in Wikipedia. And it'll say, confusingly, linear is sometimes used to mean constant.
Constant. Yeah, that is pretty confusing.
Okay, what about K and N?
All right, K and N. So K and N. So the training process, the learning process is exactly the same as it is for one nearest neighbor, which is to say you do nothing and you pass all the data forward to the query processor. So it's going to be one N.
That is correct. Nice.
All right. Now, querying seems like it's a little more subtle. So we can find the single nearest neighbor in log N time.
Mm-hmm.
Where are we going to get the other K minus one? So I'm pretty sure that once we find the nearest neighbor, we can kind of start doing a little spread out search from there until we found the K nearest neighbors.
Sure. So you're saying, you know, you've got these points. They're already in a line. You find the nearest neighbor, you know the next nearest neighbors have to be within K of the points surrounding it. And so you could just move in kind of either direction and pick them up as you go.
Yeah, something like that.
Okay.
I mean, the way that I was thinking about it is that I think you can use the same algorithm that's used for merging lists in merge sort. But here the lists actually correspond to being to the left of the query point and being to the right of the query point. And they're both sorted in terms of their distance from the query point.
Sure. Yeah, I buy that.
So that ought to give us log N plus K.
Okay. So do we need to write the K?
I'm going to say yes, because if K is on the order of like N over 2, then it's going to dominate. If K is on the order of log N, then it's not going to dominate.
That's a good point. So, yeah, we'll do K. I will point out that if K is on the order of N over 2, you're right, it will dominate. And then really this is big O of N. But
that's
if
right.
It's on the order of log n, then it's just log n plus log n, and so it's big O of log n. But you're right. So we should probably keep the k around because we don't know its relationship to n. Okay, fair enough. Okay, what about the space requirements?
We know one bit of relationship. It's smaller than or equal to n.
That's true.
Because that would be really weird if I gave you 10 data points and asked for the 20 nearest neighbors.
This is the sort of thing you would do.
It was the sort of thing you would do, but then it would be really confusing.
No, I mean, it's the sort of thing you would do. Let's go to Wikipedia. Confusingly, 20 is sometimes mean to meant 10. Okay, so what about space?
Space. So I don't understand why it would ever need more than constant space. So we're going to zip around in that list. I mean, I guess if we do it really badly, we can use K space to kind of copy over what those possible nearest neighbors are. But we don't need to keep track of them. We can just point to them in place. So it's constant.
Okay. Yeah, that's true. In fact, because it's sorted, all you really need to know is the beginning and the ending. So that's two things. So that's constant. Okay, cool. All right, good. So what about linear regression, your favorite little algorithm thing that you did when we talked about this before?
I do like linear regression. All right, so the learning in this case is what we're mapping a real number input to a real number output. And the way we're doing that is we're taking, it's probably like MX plus B sort of form.
Mm-hmm.
So we need to find the multiplier and the additive constant, which it seems like, well, so in general, doing a regression involves inverting a matrix. But in this case, I think the matrix that we're talking about is of constant size. So inverting it is constant time. I think it's as easy as basically just scanning through the list to populate that constant size matrix. So I'm going to say order n.
Yep.
To process the data.
That is correct.
And there's probably a really nice algorithm for that.
Yeah, probably some kind of linear regression algorithm.
Yeah. No, I mean, like, the general linear regression algorithm is involves inverting a matrix.
Right.
Or something like it, something equivalent to it. But here, because it's all in scalar land, I think it's simpler.
Yeah, I think that's right. Okay, so what about space?
All right, so space in terms of the data that you pass forward from the learning algorithm to the regressor is just, well, mx plus b. It's just m and b, which is constant. There's the two numbers.
Right, so that's two. Two is like one for sufficiently large values of one. So it's constant.
Yeah. All right, now at query time, you give me an x, I multiply it by m and add b.
Mm-hmm.
So that's constant time.
Yep.
So before, the query cost was expensive and the learning cost was cheap, and now we've kind of swapped that around.
Yeah, we have. So space would be...
Space. Oh, that you're asking me.
Yes.
Space for the query would be constant as well.
Right, exactly. So yeah, so you made a good point here. So earlier on, we had this situation where learning was fast, constant, and querying was, you know, not as fast. It was, you know, probably logarithmic. But in the linear regression case, learning was expensive, and the querying was easy. So we swapped them around. That's exactly right. So why would you care about that? Well, let's see. I'll point out something, which is though even though we swapped out what was expensive in terms of time and what wasn't, you'll notice that it's only logarithmic at query time for these first two, but it's linear for the learning time in linear regression. So doesn't that mean that linear regression is always slower and worse?
Well, not really. I mean, because we don't know how many times. We only have to learn once, but we could query many, many times.
Right. Right. So I guess if we query more than, you know, n times, for example, it'll certainly be worse overall in terms of running time.
That's right.
Okay.
Though it's interesting because, like, when I see numbers like this, my algorithm hat tells me that I should try to balance them a little bit more. Like, here it's you can make learning essentially free, and the other one you can make querying essentially free. Really, you want to split those somewhat evenly, though it's not obvious to me how you would do that. Like, square root of n learning time and then square root of n query time or something like that.
Yeah, but you did say something else that was important, right, which is that you only have to learn once.
Yeah, it's true.
So the balance, you know, it really depends on how often you're going to do querying and exactly what power it gives you. I mean, the trade-off is really there, don't you think?
Yeah, I guess so. I mean, so specifically in the version where you just query once,
right,
then the balance thing could be more interesting.
Sure. Okay, cool. All right, anything else you want to observe about this? Let's see. We got the trade-off between learning versus querying. So either you do all your work up front or you put it off and do your work only when you're forced to at query time.
Yeah, I guess, one thing is I want to point out that there's a nice Mr. Rogers reference in the title. That was very cool.
Thank you very much.
And the second thing is that it does strike me, in a sense, that what's going on here for the nearest neighbor algorithms is you just put off doing any work until you absolutely have to,
mm-hmm.
which strikes me as kind of a procrastinatory approach.
So that's a good word that you use there, procrastinate. The words that people use in the literature are lazy.
Mm.
They say that these are lazy learners versus something like linear regression, which is an eager learner.
Eager.
Yes. So linear regression is eager. It wants to learn right away, and it does. But nearest neighbor algorithms are lazy. They want to put off doing any learning until they absolutely have to at query time. And so we refer to these classes lazy and this class as eager.
I see. So I guess it's the case that if we never query it, then the lazy learner definitely comes out ahead.
Right. That makes sense. It's just-in-time learning, or Jill, or Jittle, I guess, which doesn't roll off the tongue anywhere near as well. Okay, cool. So we've gotten through this quiz. Would you like to do another one?
Yeah, I just have to get this Jittle off my tongue.